1 John chapter 3, where our lesson is taken this morning. Certainly good to see each and every one with us, especially if you're visiting with us. Once you know you are a guest, invite you back at any opportunity that you might have. Also, since the youth are going to do their thing next Sunday night, we will postpone the men's business meeting to the next week. That wasn't on the schedule when I looked at it, so anyway, put it off 1 week would be fine on that, so keep that in mind. Men's business meeting will be the 11th instead of the 4th there to accommodate the youth for what they're going to do at that time. Had a good trip. Bill, Pam, I, and Susan at polishing the pulpit. Heard some good lessons. There was a man there I had heard Brother DeBerry long before polishing the pulpit. I'd heard him a couple of times, and was privileged to hear him two times. Bill and I were this time around. One had to do with the fact that when man wants to be God, and the other had to do with abortion. And so, one of the Sunday nights that I'm not here, or so, we will play that where everyone can hear it. There, we did buy the DVDs that went along with those two lessons and a few other lessons as well there, and you would enjoy them. Brother DeBerry is one of our black brethren, and he is a Tennessee legislature from Shelby County, Tennessee, and if you listen to him, you wonder how in the world he can get it all out. It doesn't ever seem to take a breath. It's just one continual flow from beginning to the end there. And he is amazing, and he is a great speaker. So anyway, we enjoyed some good times, some good lessons there while we were there. And we going to hopefully do some things a little different than what we possibly have done in the past because of suggestions that we've made, things we may have learned there. So anyway, we look forward to next year or the year after going to polishing the pulpit. It's a good thing. All right, the book of 1 John chapter 3, we see that God loves those that are his children. As a matter of fact, in this particular passage, verse 1, he calls them sons of God. Other chapters, other places, he calls them daughters of God. So we have sons and daughters of God. God considers his children to be his sons and his daughters. Now that within itself shows a relationship. It shows a relationship that many times we never grasp. It's like the relationship of brother and sister, the relationship of husband and wife that God, when he made woman for man, they twain became one flesh. It's all about being one. One as far as our marriages are concerned, one as far as the church is concerned. Although there are many of us here, there's only one church. We're all working for the same goal. We should be united. And when we see God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the unity that they have in Scripture, we should see the unity that we should have, not only in our marriages, but what we should have as far as a congregation of God's people is concerned. Now, sometimes we don't see that till way in life. But brethren, that's the picture that God has in the Bible as far as man is concerned and his part and his place in the big picture that God had when he created the universe and put man in that. That we were to be united as a family, and that we were to let our light so shine that the world could see the church in us, could see Christ, could see God, could see the Holy Spirit in our lives as well. But times are not like they used to be years and years ago. Seemingly, we have too many things that are drawing us away from that which God would have us to be. Stop and think about the way things were 50, 60 years ago. That'd be hard for some of you because some of you wasn't even born 50 years ago. But be that as it may, 50 years ago, some of the moral decay that we have today didn't exist. Now, it existed, but it was not prevalent like it is today. Today, every time you turn around, you're seeing moral decay being displayed on television. You're seeing moral decay displayed in the lives of people, in the way they dress, the way they talk, the way they do things in life. That years ago was really not as bad. Now, that's not to say there's always been moral decay to a certain extent in the world, but not to the extreme that it is today. People are immoral in the world in which we live. Today we have people that commit murder for no reason. They just want to kill. That's all they know. That's what they've been taught. That's what they've been brought up to do, is to kill. You have all these gangs. You have all these different and various things that are happening in America today. The moral decay is at its greatest height. Moral values back in 50 years ago were not taken for granted. Moral values were taught. Today we don't teach moral values like we should. The school system used to teach moral values. They're not even allowed to do such anymore as far as the school system is concerned. And so you see, times have changed over the years, and not for the good, but for the bad. People used to be married and then have babies. Today we have babies and then get married, maybe. We have not taught the Word of God when it comes to morals the way we should have. There were things that happened today that would not be tolerated 50 years ago. And I don't have to bring those out because you can remember and you know those things as well. Today we're redefining deviant behavior. With all these school killings, gang wars, and different various things, people killing their parents for no reason, apparent reason whatsoever, for people to go and to randomly shoot hundreds of people, 50, 60, 20, 30, 5, 10, you name it, every time you pick up the paper or you open, watch the news, it's always somebody's been killed, somebody's been killed, somebody's been killed, and we're trying to blame the guns for it. Guns don't kill, people kill. Guns will never shoot anyone if you never touch it, never pick it up. So the guns don't kill, it's the people that kill. But be that as it may, it's the times we're living in. It seems as though we're just trying to avoid having to do what's right in life. People seemingly don't want to do what's right. Now, the question is this: has God's law, has God's word changed since the very beginning? Well, you know and I know God's law hasn't changed. God's word hasn't changed. Take your Bible, turn to Hebrews chapter 8 and Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. It is not Christ, it is not God, it is not the Father nor the Holy Spirit that has changed, it is men that have changed. God's laws still read the same. The Bible still reads the same. It hasn't changed not one word since the day it was written. Men have tried to ignore what the Bible says. Men have tried to explain it away. Men have tried to say that the Bible is nothing more than just a regular novel that someone else has written. But friends, the Bible is much more than that. The Bible is the Word of God. It is the all-powerful Word of God. Now, the thing we have to understand is, whatever God says is sin, is sin. It hasn't changed. When God told Adam and Eve in the very beginning, the day that ye shall eat of that tree, ye shall surely die, God meant exactly what he says, and that's exactly what happened. God hasn't changed one bit since the day of creation. God is not going to change in our lifetime. God is not going to change anytime in the future as far as his teachings according to the things that he believes is right and wrong, and he demands that you and I follow after. Now, when we transgress God's law, according to 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4, because that's what sin is, a transgression of God's law. Now, there are several ways that we can do that. And this morning, we want to focus upon some of those ways, some of the ways that men seemingly try to wander around and not pay attention to what's going on. First of all, we want to talk about the fact that sin is always sin, even if you are influenced by someone else to do it. We live in a world today where it is not my fault. Nobody, may I say nobody, wants to take the blame for anything anymore. And that's even in the Lord's church, I'm afraid. No one wants to take the blame for what is done. We play the blame game as such, just as Eve did, just as Adam did. Eve passed it on to the serpent, and then, of course, Adam passed it on. They passed the buck, and that's all we do today is pass the buck. If we do something wrong, it's not our fault. Somebody else made us do it. Now, friends, you know that's not true. The fact is, you did it. Admit it. Repent and move on. And that's what we need to do rather than the fact of trying to make excuses. A lot of times people will say, well, I'm from a dysfunctional family. Well, let me tell you something, brethren, about dysfunctional families. We're all dysfunctional. And the reason we're dysfunctional because we don't always do what's right. So that makes us dysfunctional. So what? You still know the difference between right and wrong. You know that what you're about to do is wrong. Doesn't matter if your buddy right there that's been your buddy for 10 years is pushing you in the back and saying, go ahead, go ahead. You're still wrong because sin is sin. And just because you're going to do it, not going to mean that sin's going to change. We live in a world today where we talk about being progressive. We talk about being far superior than people in the past. We're not acting like it. We're acting like we're more stupid than people were in the past because of the way we live, because of the way we think. People today have the idea they can live together before marriage. The Bible teaches that such as fornication or even adultery could possibly be that. But the fact is, it's sinful and it's wrong, and nobody makes you do it. It is a choice made by you and you only. We all have our problems. Back in the years ago when I was growing up in high school, the kids, and of course we all were kids back then at one time or another, we would fight from time to time. We'd get into an argument with our buddy or whatever, and we might even go out and have a fist fight. But today, you don't fist fight. Today, you have a knife or you have a gun. What happened to reasoning with people? We tell you we're progressive? I say we're going backwards and not forwards, friends. There's nothing progressive about the way we try to handle problems today. We all have problems, but the thing is how we deal with those problems that builds character, that builds integrity, that builds trust. How do we deal with problems today? Members in the church cry, this is a dead congregation. Well, why is it dead? If it's a dead congregation, who makes up the church? The members do. Think about that. We're all members. We're all in the same boat, friends. So it's not possible for one member to say this church is dead and it be truthful. Because if it's dead, then he's dead too, or she's dead too. Because a dead congregation involves all members of the congregation there. It doesn't just involve the elders or the deacons. It involves the whole congregation. Be careful what you say, because if you say it's a dead church, you've included yourself in this deal. Why do you think the church is dead? Why? Because things are not going on? Well, who does the work of the Lord's church? Think about it, brethren. It is the people, the members of the congregation that do the work of the Lord's church. If members are not willing to work, the work doesn't get done. It's that simple. It's not hard. This is not a PhD degree here. You don't have to realize that you've got to have somebody come in from the outside to do the work of the church. It doesn't work that way. God never intended to be that way. You see, friends, it doesn't matter who makes you do what you do. You do it because you choose to do it. And if the church is dead, it's because you allowed it to be dead. You choose to allow it to be dead. You can do something about it. I can do something. We all can do something about it. But if all we're going to do is talk about it, going to happen, is it? I want you to look at something with me, if you will. Book of Ezekiel. In the Old Testament, the prophet wrote, beginning in verse 2 of chapter 18, he says, "What mean ye, that ye use this proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge? As I live, saith the Lord God, ye shall not have occasion any more to use this proverb in Israel. Behold, all souls are mine. As the soul of the father, so also the soul of the son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die." Now look down in verse 19. "Yet say ye, why doth not the son bear the iniquity of the father? When the son hath done that which is lawful and right, and hath kept all my statutes, and hath done them, he shall surely live. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him." You see, friends, when it comes to sin, nobody makes you do it. You choose to do it. It's your choice. The father doesn't bear the sins of his son. The son doesn't bear the sins of his father. And so that's the way it is, and that's the way God has had it from the very beginning. So we need to stop using and saying, "Somebody else made me do it." Nobody else made you do it, friends. I love you, but you did it on your own because you chose to do it. Second of all, sin is always sin, even if it's legalized. Yes, we have legalized sin in America today. For example, abortion. Abortion was legalized in 1972. It has been going on for, how many years is that? 28 and 16, that's about 44 years. Maybe I miscalculated, but you figured it up. 44 years that we've been taking the innocent lives of children. Children in the womb that have no say whatsoever about whether they're going to live or whether they're going to die. Jerk them out, take them out, plunge them in the head. Many of them to the point to where they cry when they're killed. And yet it is legal in America to abort a child. You go and you take a sea turtle leg and see what happens to you. You will go to prison for it, but you do not have to worry about going to prison if you abort a child. Look, if you would, in the book of Psalms. In Psalm 139, beginning with verse 12, I believe it is, notice what the psalmist wrote pertaining to this very idea. Psalm 139, beginning with verse 12. "Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. For thou hast possessed my reins. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was in the secret, made in secret, and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth." Now God knows, the psalmist says God knew him when he was in his mother's womb. There are a lot of mothers who have aborted children that are going to have to answer for it on the judgment day for having taken a life unless they repent of it. There are a lot of people in the world today that are going to have to answer for the murder of a child in the mother's womb. I don't know if we really fully understand what takes place in an abortion. What happens at the time that death comes to that child? Many times they stick something into their brain which kills them. That's the way they kill them. Take them. It is amazing how a doctor who has given his life to protecting the lives of people is willing to take the life of an unborn child who doesn't have a fighting chance in the world. And yet it is legalized in the world in which we live. Someone has estimated there are 1.6 million abortions a year in America alone. And then there's the idea of divorce. We talk about being legalized. Well, now, divorce is legal as far as the Bible is concerned, so long as it is for fornication, for the cause of fornication, Matthew chapter 19, verse 9. Divorce is not legal for desertion. Divorce is not legal just because we agree to disagree. We live in a world today where all you have to do is agree to disagree and you can get a divorce. We live in a world today where you can get a divorce if your husband deserts you. And you can get a divorce for about any reason or any cause in the world in which you live. But the Bible says there is but one cause that one should put away his mate. That is for the cause of fornication. And so we need to keep that in mind. It may be legalized. The state of Mississippi may recognize that divorce, but friends, that's not what counts. It's the God in heaven. Does he recognize that divorce? And you need to think seriously about those things, because the world's not going to tell you anything different. Matter of fact, the denominational world, they don't really care whether or not you're divorced, remarried, and whatever, how many times you want to, it doesn't matter. The Bible does. When we talk about gambling, gambling is legalized. It's a $100 million a month deal on the Gulf Coast. And much money is taken from people who need it because they have a habit they can't control. And we try to justify, years ago when this came up in the state of Mississippi, the big push on this thing was that education would never have to worry about funding anymore. Where are we at today? We're trying to fund education. We haven't fully funded it since all this mess began. And it's not going to be fully funded because of the fact we have too many people gambling it away, giving it away. Friends, you know, and I know, and if you got good sense about you, you know that if somebody wins, somebody has to lose. As a matter of fact, there are more losers than there are winners, and you know that. They're not in the business of giving money away. You understand that, right? Do we need to put it here on the diagram on the board to figure this thing out? That if you gamble, you're giving your money to them. Yes, you may get some in return at one time or another. You might hit a jackpot, but more than likely, you're not going to hit one. You're taking a chance. You're taking from someone else, your neighbor. You remember what the Bible said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy strength. And the second is likened to it, love thy neighbor as thyself. When you win, your neighbor loses. Somebody had to lose money in order for you to have money, gain money. And there's the gambling part of it. Even though it's legal, yes, you can do it in the state of Mississippi, and it won't be long that we're going to be involved into the Powerball stuff. And then you can really make some good money then if you hit the jackpot. But friends, it's not legal. It's still sin. It's sin because you're gambling. It's not the amount of money you're gambling that makes it wrong. It's the whole concept of it. And let me say this while I'm here. There are a lot of members of the Lord's church that would not go to Tunica. They would not go to a casino and gamble. But they don't bat an eye at buying a raffle ticket. And it's the same principle. It's the exact same principle. You buy a raffle ticket for the school. You buy a raffle ticket for the hospital. You buy a raffle ticket to win a gun. You buy a raffle ticket to do this, that, and the other. You're gambling. It's the same principle involved. Maybe not as much money. You may be putting $5 or $10 rather than $1,000 or $100, but you can go to the casino and play the penny slots. I noticed a woman this last week in the paper won $24,000 playing a penny slot. But it don't make it right. It's not the amount of money you're gambling. It's the principle. It's the concept. You're taking from someone else so that you can have. Well, then there's the idea of homosexuality. Homosexuality is now legal in the United States. You can now live with your partner. You now have as many rights as any of the rest of us. But let me tell you something, brethren. The Bible condemns it. In Galatians chapter 5, 19 through 21, it's said it is a sin, and they that do such shall not inherit the kingdom of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, they were guilty of doing the very same thing. But you know, the good thing about this, if we'd only think about it in the right way, people can get out of it. You don't have to stay in that condition. Nobody has to stay in a lost condition. But here's the question. Where is our outrage change this thing, to turn it around in the way that it should go. If you notice in Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 20, Isaiah says, "Woe unto them that call evil good, good evil, that put darkness for light, light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet, and sweet for bitter." Acts chapter 5 and verse 29, the apostle John and Peter had been arrested, and there they were before the council, and they were told, "You no longer speak in the name of Jesus Christ." And they said, "We ought to obey God rather than men." You see, even if it's legal, and the Bible says it's wrong, it's wrong. Sin will always be sin, even if it's legalized. Third of all, sin is always going to be sin regardless of how you feel about it. You know, God created man and put us here upon this earth so that we could hopefully have fellowship with Him. That's the whole purpose of all this that we go through in life, is to have fellowship with God. And we have to be in a right relationship in order to have fellowship with God. In other words, we have to live as God would have us to live. God is one who has no sin, who has never committed sin, who never allows you to be sinned or allow sin to overtake you more than you're able. So that's a good consolation to know that God's not going to allow us to be tempted above that which we're able to bear. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. But He will, with the temptation, also make a way of escape. You see? Now, someone says, "Well, you know, I know that God condemns such, but I really don't see anything wrong with it." It's not a matter of what you see. If God condemns it, that's all that matters, friends. It doesn't matter how you feel about it. It doesn't matter what you think about it. God says it's wrong, then it's wrong. You can try to reason it for the rest of your life, but you need to also keep in mind your reasoning and God's reasoning are not the same. That's Isaiah chapter 59, verses, 7 and 8. God's thinking is different from your thinking. Don't even try to compare. Don't even try to make a comparison between your brain and the brain there in the God of heaven. You can't do it, because His thinking and your thinking are not the same. When we begin to reason among ourselves and we begin to say, "I believe, I think," we're in trouble. We're in trouble. Now, the Bible tells us that lying is wrong. Men's have the idea, you know, what's a little white lie? I didn't tell the full truth, but I didn't really tell a big black lie. Well, if you didn't tell the truth, you lied. And that's just the way it is. And we lie about a lot of things, and we're all guilty from time to time. The Bible says that lasciviousness is wrong, Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21. Lasciviousness is the unchaste handling of males and females, young boys and young girls who date, begin to explore and to touch, and they should not, because that's what marriage is all about. Drinking is wrong. Some say, "Well, I don't see, the Bible doesn't say thou shalt not drink." No, the Bible doesn't say that. A lot of things the Bible doesn't say, but when God tells us what to do, He should not have to tell us what not to do. We understand that principle and everything, except when it comes to religion. We don't understand it in religion for some reason. In the 70s, we used to call this situation ethics a lot of times about sin. You know, find yourself in a situation, say, if you're down in Florida and you're down on the beach and everybody else is naked and they got their bikinis on, then that's the thing that we do. We mingle right in, because after all, it's situation ethics. I mean, this is where I'm at. This is how people are dressed. I don't want to be a stick in the mud. Therefore, I dress like they are. No, that's not what the Bible teaches. I realize that's what people reason. In the 80s, instead of calling it situation ethics, we called it values clarification. Values clarification. No, it's still sin. You can put any kind of name on it you want to, friends. It's still sin. I mean, it's not right to do that. Sex before marriage may be sin to you. Sex before marriage to someone else might not be sin. That's what people would say. And there are a lot of people in the world today that have no pre-admission. They will not tell you at all that sex before marriage is wrong. They don't think it's wrong. But the Bible says it's wrong. It's called fornication. It's called lasciviousness. And yet, today we live in society that we hear it on television. Our children see it all the time. They hear it all the time. Now, let me ask you an honest question. What do you think your children think? What do you think your children think? Something you need to ask yourself. That's why we have so many in the church today that are trying to say we need to rethink the church. We've got to redo the church because the church is out of tune with times, and we've got to change some things so that we can get it more up to date. Well, you better be careful how you update it. Yes, there are some things that we can change, but there are some things that we cannot change. The Bible has given us the doctrine by which we are to follow. God has given us a pattern by how we worship. We cannot change it, regardless of whether we choose to or not. I don't care if it's inconvenient. We're going to have Christmas coming up on Sunday this year. And we'll see just how many really believe in Christianity. How many of you really believe that what you believe? Will you be here Sunday? Well, you should be. Supposedly, and I say supposedly because I don't believe Jesus was born on Christmas. I don't believe that's right. I believe they have it backwards. I believe they have Easter and Christmas backwards, personally. But the fact of the matter still remains, Christmas is coming on Sunday. You have to come to church on the first day of the week, friends, in order to worship God. That's a commandment. How many of us will be here when that time comes? Well, regardless of how you feel, sin is still going to always be sin. Because you believe, because you think, is not going to change the fact that sin is sin. And then we see, fourth of all, that sin is going to always be sin no matter who does it. You know, one of the greatest arguments my children used to use against me when they were growing up is that, Daddy, everybody else is doing it, why can't I? Yep, they sure are, son, but you're not going to. You see, brethren, sin is not going to change by who does it. The Bible talks about, I think, what is 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 20 through 22. He talks about those that go back into the world. They've been better off had they never known the truth. And after they've known the truth, to go back into the world, turn from it. Because he views them as the pig that to the wallowing in the mire that had been washed. To the dog that throws up to vomit and eats it. That's what he compares this to, per se. So it's not a matter of who does it. Doesn't matter if the elders are involved, it's still sin. Doesn't matter if the preacher's involved, it's still sin. Doesn't matter if their family's involved, it's still sin. It's not going to change simply because of who's involved in it. Now, it may cause us to change our mind and our belief about it, but it's still going to be sin no matter how much we change our mind about it. If sin is sin, it's going to always be sin, friends. It's not going to change by who's done it. And then fifth of all, sin is going to always be sin even if no one sees you. I mean, let me tell you something. There's a lot of people gotten away with murder in this country, in this world. I'm talking about murder. Just cold-hearted murder. They never had to pay a day in this life. But they will one day. When the judgment day comes, they'll spend eternity in the place prepared for the devil and his angels there. How many of us ever creeped through a stop sign? How many of us ever ran a stop sign? How many of us ever ran a red light? Well, I think we're probably all guilty there. We all make mistakes. Sometimes we don't see the red light. Sometimes we don't see the stop sign. And sometimes we see it, but we don't really stop. We just kind of hit the brakes and go right on through because, after all, there's no one looking on the corner. The policeman's not there. How many of us drive 50 in a 45, or how many of us drive 60 in a 55? Or we drive 70? Well, you see, the law's the law. Now, where do we draw the line at the law there? Well, some people say, well, nobody got caught. Well, that may be true. Nobody does get caught sometimes. But does it make it right? And that's the point. I've always wondered why my brethren carry around that used to, years ago, they used to have these radar detectors. Well, why do you have those for? If you're doing what's right, you don't have to worry about that. If you're obeying the law, why do you need a radar detector? Well, you know why you need a radar detector, because you're not obeying the law. That's exactly right. You're going too fast. And in the book of Proverbs, chapter 15, verse 3, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the good and the evil there. There's a song we sing, there's an all-seeing eye watching you. Well, it's kind of like what we have here in services, is it not? God is here in the presence. He's here with us this morning. He's here with us every service. But we don't see him, and because we don't see him, we don't see that there's any great need to really do more than what we do in worship service. But I tell you what, I can assure you, if God the Father was there, Jesus beside him, and the Holy Spirit over here, we could see them. I can assure you, that everyone in this building would worship God completely different that day. I guarantee it. And you know why, and I know why. You see, that's the thing. Here's our problem. Simply because we don't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. You believe in God. You believe that he exists. You believe that one day you'll stand in judgment of him, but you don't see him here in the services. And therefore, you don't participate. You don't do what you should. But sin is going to always be sin, even though no one sees you. Sixth of all, sin is always sin, even when you do it for a good cause. What are you talking about, preacher? What do you mean do it for a good cause? The book of Romans chapter 3 and verse 8, Paul said, let us do evil that good may come. No. We don't do evil so that good may come. This goes back to the idea of what I was talking about a while ago as far as gambling is concerned. Sometimes we'll buy a raffle ticket. And years ago we used to build the St. Jude Dream Home. Our company did. We built three of them. And of course, if you know anything about that, they raffle that thing off for a $100 ticket. You pay $100 and you have a chance of winning this home. And so the opportunity abound, people, for a good cause. You know, if it's a good cause and you want to help a good cause, send a check to them. Why do you have to buy a raffle ticket? Why do you have to do that? Just send them a check for X amount of dollars. And you don't gamble. And you're doing what's right. And it's that way about everything. Kids used to try to sell us raffle tickets when we was growing up. Of course, every time you're in school, you got somebody, I got a raffle ticket. I say, here's $5. Forget the raffle. I'll give it to you. I'll give it to you called, but I'm not buying a raffle ticket. And that's the way I dealt with it. If you don't buy the ticket, then you're not guilty of committing being gambling. But if you buy that ticket, you're guilty. So, you know, this, even for a good cause, yes, the ends does not justify the means. Who you're trying to help may be a good cause, but how you're trying to help them is not the right way. It's not the right way to do it. And we understand that. Seventh of all, sin is sin even if others are doing worse things. Even if others are doing worse things. There are a lot of people in the world that are very sinful. They do things that are not right in God's sight. And as bad as I hate to say it, there are members of the Lord's church do the same thing. They don't do what's right. They fail. They make mistakes. Someone will say, oh, so-and-so is doing that, and they're a member of the Lord's church. But does that make them right? Would it make it right if the elders did it? Or would it make it right if the preacher did it? No, God's word's still going to read the same on the day of judgment, whether the elders do it or whether the preacher does it or whether whoever does it. If it's sin, it's sin, brother. You can't change it. And that's what my point is this morning is, sin is going to always be sin regardless. God does not change his view. God will not judge us righteous just because we can point to someone else and say, well, he's doing worse. And see, I'm not near as sinful as he is. The fact is, you said it in your statement. You're sinful. And that's what God does not want. Matthew 5:20. 20. He says that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of scribes and Pharisees, ye in no case shall enter the kingdom of heaven. Romans chapter 10, verse 3, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness have not submitted unto the righteousness of God. And that's important because it's the righteousness of God we're concerned about. I'm not concerned about how righteous anyone else is. A lot of times we want to compare ourselves to men. You need to compare yourself to God, to Jesus Christ, while he was up on the earth. He is the example for us to follow. And finally, sin is always going to be sin, even if it doesn't bother your conscience. Even if it doesn't bother your conscience. You know, a conscience has to be trained. For a conscience to be one that you might could fall back on would have to be well grounded in the Word of God. I mean, you wouldn't take the mind of a criminal and say his conscience is a good conscience to follow, would you? No. There are some on death row right now that just soon shoot you as look at you. I mean, his conscience wouldn't bother him one bit to see you dead, to see your brain splattered all over the wall. It wouldn't bother him at all, or her for that matter. And so your conscience cannot be your guide. Only if it's trained in the right direction there. And we have to be careful with our conscience because according to the scripture, look at 1 Timothy 4:2, speaking lies and hypocrisy and having their consciences seared with a hot iron. You see, your conscience can become seared. And then in Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 13, but exhort one another daily while it's called today, lest any of you harden your heart through the deceitfulness of sin. Your heart is your consciousness. Your heart becomes hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. You know, if someone plays in sin long enough, that sin doesn't bother them anymore. It's like missing the church services. You miss it one time, the second time it doesn't hurt near as bad, and before long your conscience doesn't bother you at all about missing the Lord's church, the services of the Lord. And so we have to be careful, but it doesn't matter whether your conscience hurts you or not, sin is still going to be sin. And that's our point. And that's what we need to understand this morning when we look at our lives and we look at things that happen. If we're not careful, we will change with the world gradually. I mean, Satan doesn't want to win you over overnight. He doesn't care about that. Satan may take years to win you over to his side. And in the world, in the church today, we've got too many people that are straddling the fence. We've got too many people that want to be Christians, but at the same time, they want to be worldly. You can't do that. The Bible tells us it's impossible. Matter of fact, Jesus said it's impossible to do that. You cannot love the world and love God at the same time. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So what do we seek first? We seek the kingdom. We seek the church. We seek God first. Brethren, we've got to go back to the Bible. And we've got to understand, if God says something is a sin, it doesn't make any difference how I wrap it up. It doesn't make any difference how I present it. It's not going to change the fact that it's sin. My mother used to try to feed us, when I was young, beef liver. I am not a fan of beef liver. She would try to cover that taste up. There is no way in the world you can cover up the taste of beef liver. It's the texture of the beef itself you can taste. She tried, and I never fell for it. Don't you fall for what the world gives is all right, but in reality is sinful. Think about it. If you're here this morning and not a member of the Lord's church, the greatest thing that one can do is obedience to the gospel of cleanse. Hear the word, believe it, act upon believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God by repenting of your sins. That is changing your life, changing the way you think, the way you do things. By confessing Jesus Christ as the Son of God, being baptized for the remission of your sins in order that your sins might be forgiven. The Lord will add you to his church. If you are here, a member of the Lord's church, and you've not lived the life you know you should have, then this is a great time and a great opportunity to make things right. We encourage you to do that as together we stand.